Our next talk is by, it's a duo, Ross Knepper and Steffi Telex. This is a best paper nomination, and they're going to be talking about asking for help using natural language, and not just in any way, but in an illegible way, actually, a way that allows people to understand.
Here we go. I'm going to tell you a story about IkeaBot, which is a system that we're developing in my lab. These robots are able to autonomously assemble furniture, and someday maybe they'll come into your home and assemble your IKEA furniture for you. And the system development is coming along pretty well. They can assemble these tables. But one day I noticed this weird kind of failure condition. So the robot was navigating. It was just trying to get around a table. And it got stuck, and it was in this oscillation. And I was really annoyed by this for two reasons. First of all, it was ruining my experiment. But secondly, it was my thesis code. So I'd spent 5 years developing this at CMU. And I put it on my robot at MIT. And I was probably the only one in the world who knew how to fix this failure, because it's a really weird failure, right? So I had to shove the robot, not just once, but twice. And finally, it was working again, right? So I'm thinking, you know, here I am, the only one in the world. I'm the expert user. And I want my robots to go out into the world and do great things. And I want them to be able to find a way to articulate, you know, so that they can get users to help them when they get stuck.
So when I met Ross, I had been just finishing up a whole bunch of work on making robots that understood natural language commands that people spoke. So here, the person says something, and then the robot does something. And we got this running on lots and lots of different robots. Especially hard to watch the forklift, because this was joint work with Seth Teller. And I had thought about like inverting this and trying to make robots say things, but I wasn't sure what they should be saying. And I really didn't want to make Clippy the robot that was saying stupid things that didn't really mean anything. So I wasn't really sure where to go from there.
So when I was first trying to solve this problem of getting robots to get help from people, first thing I thought about is, well, the robot could just say, help me, right? And then at least the human knows there's something wrong, and maybe if they just examine the scene, they could figure out what to do.
But that doesn't work. In a complex environment, it's really not clear what action a person should take to help the robots, especially a person not familiar with the robotic system.
So the next thing I thought about is, well, we could do some kind of semi-hard-coded template where we can plug in the names of the things that we're asking for help about.
And that's better. At least you know you're supposed to pick up something and hand it off to the robot. But in this environment, there's three different white table legs that aren't yet attached to an object in the environment. And the one the robot needs is the one that's out of its reach on that table. That's the one it can't pick up autonomously. And this type of template-based approach isn't able to generate those types of specific requests. So the aim of this work is to enable robots to generate specific and targeted natural language requests that reflect the complexity of the environment and change dynamically in different environments so that a person can easily and quickly infer what actions they should take so that the robots can continue operating autonomously.
So this work represents really the convergence of two separate research questions. Firstly, how does the robot determine what it wants the person to do in order to remedy these kind of failures? This is fundamentally a problem of planning for collaboration.
And second, once the collaborative planner has figured out what physical actions the robot should take in the world, or the robot would like the person to take in the world, we need to figure out how to describe it. What words does the robot use in order to ask the person to take those actions? And we're going to describe an approach to generate these types of expressions, these types of sentences, using inverse semantics. These two research questions are closely intertwined. That's the reason we chose to share this talk at RSS. So the outline of the talk today is we're going to discuss prior work, then we're going to discuss our solution approach, which has these two components, planning for collaboration, and then language generation with inverse semantics. And then we'll conclude by discussing our evaluation. So we conducted an online corpus-based study to see how well it works using Amazon Mechanical Turk, and we also conducted a real-world evaluation with real people and real robots interacting to assemble IKEA furniture to see if they could provide help to the robots in real life. So there's been a lot of previous work in computational linguistics on generating language, but all of this work relies on a symbolic representation of what's out there in the environment. So it doesn't really work for robots because it doesn't take into account the perceptual features of the environment and the ambiguity that can be inherent in the real world. In the past few years, there's been a lot of work understanding language for robots, and I alluded to some of that at the beginning of the talk. And this work does take into account what's out there in the environment and enables robots to understand the same command in different environments that it may have never seen before at training time. And we thought maybe we could leverage this ability in order to create our language generation algorithm. So the approach that we're going to tell you about today tries to unify natural language generation and natural language understanding. We're going to describe a Bayesian approach for generating grounded natural language sentences for robots that ask for help from people by inverting our previous language understanding framework. We're going to use that understanding framework as a model for how a person would understand that natural language request. The mathematical approach we're going to take is related to Anka Dragan and Sid Srinivasa's work on legible and predictable motion. We're really excited about it because we think it represents a foundation for a principled mathematical framework for human-robot communication.
So now we're going to move on and explain our solution to this problem, starting with planning for collaboration. The IKEABot planner uses a strip-style symbolic planner, as we're all familiar with, and each action is prefaced by some preconditions that have to be true, and then a postcondition that's guaranteed. So for example, if there's a free robot gripper and there's a free leg on the ground, the robot could pick up that leg and then it has a leg in hand. You can chain these together. In fact, the planner promises that a particular sequence of these eventually will lead to a completed table, which is great, except when one of these conditions turns out not to be true at runtime. So maybe it went to pick up the leg and it slipped out of its fingers, maybe it was out of reach on a tabletop, something went wrong. So what do we do? Of course, robots do not plan pictorially like this, they really plan symbolically.
You can't really show this to a person. They're going to have no idea what to do if you show them this type of representation.
That's fine, because we can take these symbolic requests that failed, we can figure out which ones are common failure conditions, and we can map them onto a set of parameterized symbolic requests for help. And then this is what we call the template baseline. So we can define a simple function in which we define an English sentence and plug in those parameters in order to formulate a request for help.
But this type of template-based approach doesn't really change in response to different environments. So here, it'll generate these ambiguous sentences where hand me the white leg isn't clear about what object the robot should pick up in the environment. What we'd really like to say in this scene is something like, hand me the white leg that's on the table. Now the person knows exactly what object to manipulate and exactly what to do with it. And this sentence, this language, is specific to this particular environment. So we need a way to generate language that takes into account that environmental context. In order to do this, what we have to do is map between words and language and stuff that's out there in the world. So a phrase like, this is our inverse semantics framework. So a phrase like the table maps to an object that's out there in the environment. The noun phrase, the white leg that's on the table, maps to a specific part that the robot would like the person to manipulate in the environment. And the entire sentence, hand me the white leg on the table, maps to an action, the physical action that the robot's collaborative planning framework has inferred the person should take. And if they take that action, the robot's problem will be solved. So we're going to call these variables groundings. Groundings are objects, places, paths, and events or action sequences in the external world. And each grounding corresponds to a constituent phrase in the natural language input. So now we're going to talk briefly about our language understanding framework. And then after that, we're going to move to describing how we invert it to do language generation. So language understanding, or forward semantics, is the problem of inferring groundings in the world that map to natural language input. So the person says something and the robot does something. Formally, it's an optimization over the probability of those groundings given the words in the language. And in our previous work, we showed we could factor this distribution according to the tree structure of language, according to the parse tree structure of a natural language command. And this factorization enabled us to quickly and efficiently train model parameters and run inference. So what this looks like when we search for groundings is the person says something like, hand me the white leg on the table. And then the robot runs inference to figure out what it should do. So for a phrase like the table, it'll consider different objects in the environment. So here it's considering the part that's underneath the table. And the semantics model will give it a score, in this case a low score, because that object doesn't match the words table very well. If we consider a different object, it'll get a higher score because it does match. This search happens at each level of the parse tree. So the white leg on the table, this one gets a low score because it's a white leg, but it's not on the table, versus that one which gets a high score. At the top level, it'll search for actions that the robot's going to take. So it'll search through different possible actions in the world that the robot would take and find the one that best corresponds to the natural language input.
We trained our model by building a corpus which affiliates language with trajectories in the world of parts, people, and so on. And we collected this data using Amazon Mechanical Turk. We filmed these videos of a human doing assembly tasks. We recorded in motion capture the trajectories of the human and all of the parts. And we asked the users to type what words you would use to ask the person to do the task that you see them doing. We collected 326 different phrases, different help requests, and we associated all of these with the actions so that we could build up a corpus.
So that's how our language understanding framework works. Now we're going to describe how to invert this model in order to do language generation. So to do language generation, this is inverse semantics. It's again an optimization. It's trying to figure out what language specifies the grounding. So here it's an optimization over sentences that the robot might say of the same thing as understanding, the probability of the groundings given the language. And these groundings are specified by the symbolic input. The only thing different about these two expressions is what we're optimizing over. So in the first case, we're optimizing over groundings. In the second case, we're optimizing over language. We define a search space of sentences for this optimization using a context-free grammar. So this defines a very large space of things that the robot could say, and we'll use our semantics model to score them.
So remember that the planner gives us groundings from the symbolic parameterized request. So we already know, the robot knows, that part six refers to that part on the table there, and pickup refers to an action that it would like the human to perform. But remember that the human doesn't know these groundings.
So when our CFG generates a candidate part of the sentence it's going to say, we can map those words to something from the input from the collaborative planner, and then assign it a score using the semantics model. So in this case, these words, the black leg, don't map very well to the object because it's white and not black, so it gets a low score. So the search will try different words. In this case, it'll switch to the white leg, and the semantics model gives it a high score. And we use beam search in order to concentrate the search in the most promising parts of the search space. So we can continue generating clauses from the context-free grammar and say something like, hand me the white leg. And so the grounding for hand me is provided by the symbolic natural language request.
But at this point, we've used up all of the groundings that were provided to us by the planner, and yet you told me that the sentence is still ambiguous, so what do we do?
Exactly. So in order to fix this type of problem, we can use our CFG to generate these disambiguating clauses. So here it's considering saying, hand me the white leg on the table. But there's no more groundings provided by the collaborative planner. So in order to get this last grounding and use our semantics model to compute a score, we have to modify our optimization slightly. We have to jointly optimize over language and that subset of the groundings that's not provided by the symbolic natural language request. So in order to carry out this optimization, we can factor our distribution in the same way that we did for language understanding. But when we were doing language understanding, that 1 over z was constant. It was a normalizing constant with respect to the groundings. But here, I'll write it out what it is. It's not constant with respect to language.
But isn't that just as hard as the problem of language understanding?
Exactly. It's exactly equivalent to the problem of language understanding. And just like our language understanding models are imperfect because we can't perfectly capture how people understand language, our model of language generation is going to be limited in the same way. And we're going to use the same types of approximation techniques in order to compute this normalizing constant. I like to say we're dividing by understanding when we compute this normalization. So the best way to see how this plays out is with an example. So here, the robot is considering saying, hand me the white leg. So when we plug this into the framework, there's three different legs in the world. So what that means is the numerator of this function is going to get a high score because the leg the robot has in mind matches those words pretty well. But the denominator is also going to get a high value because there's a lot of other objects that also correspond to the natural language command. And so the overall value is going to be low. Now if we consider a disambiguating phrase like, hand me the white leg on the table, this only corresponds to one of those objects in the environment. So the numerator is still going to be high, but the denominator is going to have a much lower value. And that's going to give this sentence a much higher score in this particular environment. In a different environment with different distractor objects, the algorithm would make different decisions. We're really excited about this work because it represents steps toward a computational instantiation of some ideas from linguistics and philosophy. So the philosopher Paul Grice in 1975 proposed these maxims for what it means to be a good communicator. Be brief, be relevant, be truthful. And the mathematical models that we're presenting do this by modeling what it's like to understand the language.
So at this point, we've explained how the planning side and the language inference side come together to solve this problem. Now let's talk a little bit about the evaluation of the system. We did two evaluations. The first one was using Amazon Mechanical Turk online. So we showed a user in each trial these five scenes that were identical initially, but then they would play the video, hopefully, and they would evolve differently. And what you see here is that they're ambiguously similar to some extent. And the idea is that when the user reads that machine-generated sentence, the better the sentence is, the more they'll be able to disambiguate. So we asked the user which video best is the best response to the request for help that you're given. And as you would expect, the help me baseline performs no better than chance. The template baseline does somewhat better, but still less than 50%, so that's not great. On the opposite extreme, we wanted to know how good we could do, so we constructed this handwritten request for each video. And in the requests, we were able to get up to 94%. And we did this actually in a closed loop using Amazon Mechanical Turk. So we know we can do that well, potentially. But our inverse semantics method didn't do quite so well. It got about two-thirds correct response rate. And so there's about a 30-point gap in there that we know that there's room for improvement. We attribute that primarily to the model of human understanding. So now I'll move on, and I'll talk a little bit about the live user study that we did. And in this user study, there was a human and a team of robots. Each were assembling their own piece of furniture. The trial lasted for 15 minutes. And the robots would periodically encounter a failure, and they would ask for help. Now, there were two stage failures, but I want to emphasize that the robots detected and asked for help completely autonomously. There was no hard coding of anything. This was a live, real demo. And of course, there were some natural other failures that arose in the system. So the human would provide whatever help they thought was appropriate for the situation, and then the robots would continue to operate autonomously. And here's what it looks like. So this guy on the left is doing some important task. He doesn't want to be bothered, but the robot interrupts him, and it asks for help. And in this case, it just says, please help me. So this guy is left to figure out, you know, what the heck does this robot want? He doesn't even know which robot it is, right? It's very vague. So he spends a lot of time. It's cognitively disruptive, and he's completely forgotten what he was doing on his important task while he's trying to figure this out. So it's a huge hit to productivity. Eventually, he realizes there's this other robot over there. It looks like it might be reaching for that leg. So he hands it the leg. This counts as a successful intervention, but it came at a cost, right? There was a loss of productivity. Here's what we want to see instead. This guy hears a request for help. Please give the blue robot the white leg on the black table. And he finishes what he's doing. He doesn't stop immediately because he already understands the solution to the problem. So he can get to a nice stopping point, go intervene, and quickly return to his task. So it's a fluid motion. It's not cognitively disruptive at all. We looked at some metrics, both objective and subjective. Objectively, we asked how often did humans do the correct intervention on the first try. And this was a statistically very significant improvement with inverse semantics over that baseline. But we also looked at the overall success rate. So in a 60-second period, did people eventually figure out the correct answer? And this was a little more ambiguous in its improvement. And the reason is it's a complex system. There's a lot of things that can go wrong. For example, it's very hard to do a handoff to a robot even after you've trained the human. Subjectively, though, people really liked the system. They said that with inverse semantics, they really preferred to operate in parallel with that robot, whereas in the baseline, they more preferred to operate in serial together with the robot. There were a bunch of user comments, both primarily negative toward the baseline and primarily positive toward the inverse semantics approach. I'm not going to go through all of them for time, but you can see them on the screen here. But what we learned from this user study is that despite, you know, what we've accomplished, there's still a number of ways that the system is imperfect. So one of the big ones is that robots sometimes say things that are confusing. So for example, the robot would say near the table when it really might have wanted to say left of the table or right of the table to disambiguate.
So we're really excited about making improved models of semantics to enable robots to not only understand language more accurately, but also generate language more accurately. So using the more modern techniques and larger data sets to teach robots more words, using our framework, it's going to improve robots' language understanding as well as its language generation.
Another problem is that robots weren't always clear when they would do these help requests, even with the inverse semantics. So sometimes the user either wouldn't hear or they were confused by the request. And what do they do at that point?
So we think it's really important to give the robot more than one chance. And we're really, one of the things that my new group at Brown is working on is trying to make robots that can engage in multi-turn interactions where the robot and the person can ask questions to clarify when things aren't clearly understood the first time.
And one other thing that we noticed is that sometimes there are situations where language really doesn't quite do it. There's no clear words to explain a problem.
So we think it's really important to focus on multimodal interaction, where the robot can produce and understand both language as well as nonverbal gestures and motions.
So to wrap up, in this talk we've presented a collaborative planner that infers human actions which would help the robot.
We've presented an algorithm for generating natural language requests that exploit context to clarify the robot's intent.
And we talked about a mathematical framework which unifies both generation and understanding of language. This concludes the talk.
Thank you.
Oops. That's exciting. That talk to me offline if you want to know the full story, but it's a weird failure condition in my thesis code, basically.
Very exciting, indeed. Very, very interesting.
Thanks.
I have a question concerning the, does your robot or the system have a model of the mental state of the human it interacts with?
Right, so we encoded a model of what abilities the human has and essentially did planning on behalf of the human. And the way that we encoded that model was ourselves by hand, what actions the human could take. And we also have a model of how the person understands language. That was the forward model for understanding language. That model is trained using a data set of words which we collected from Amazon Mechanical Turk.
Very good, but does it have the current state of the mental state of the human, the current, depending on the situation?
Of course, you can't really know what's going on inside a human's head. And I think there's a lot more that could be done based on observing their actions and inferring where they might be mentally. But at the moment, we're just looking at the context, the visual scene, and assuming that if we speak clearly about that the human can figure it out.
Yeah, we're assuming they're doing some other task, so the mental state is they're not sure what they want the robot to do. One of the things my group at Brown is working on is sticking this into a PomDP model where the mental state of the human is the unobserved variable. And I'm really excited about the potential for interaction and more complex tasks that poses. Somebody over here, Ed?
Sorry. When you're trying to specify an object in the environment, there's a tension between the description length of the sentence and the ambiguity.
Yes.
And it seems like maximizing the probability would lead you towards adding descriptor clause after descriptor clause after descriptor clause. Is there a threshold? How do you resolve that?
Yeah, that gets resolved in a couple of ways. So first of all, in the two examples that I showed with like hand me the white leg that's on the table, if there was only one white leg, they would have equal probability. It wouldn't prefer one versus the other one. And so in that case, you can just prefer to say shorter things versus longer things as a threshold. The second limit we have on length is sort of inherent. We only let it run for so long, and it takes longer to find good longer sentences because the search space of those is significantly larger. And the third thing is it's only going to say things that are kind of true, right? So if there might be a longer sentence, but it doesn't match what the robot would like the person to take. So a lot of those longer ones are excluded for that reason. Thanks. More?
Yeah, if you considered using a cognitive model of the human, that long descriptions are inherently
hard. Yeah, it's basically putting a prior on sentences to say that shorter things are better.
Essentially, it won't add extra words unless they significantly aid in the understanding.
Right.
And that falls right out of the mouth.
Right.
Just curious if you thought it was important to justify the request, like, I can't reach the peg, please get me the whatever.
We didn't ever try to justify it. I think in the situation, it was clear that the robots are kind of helpless. I mean, they're small. and it's, you know, it's obvious they can't reach up on the table. So I think humans naturally, if robots are behaving civilly, humans have this natural, you know, they like to help robots.
I mean, I think that kind of politeness may well improve the system and make people more likely to respond, especially people who weren't already collaborating with the robot. So in this case, we set things up. We said, you're going to be working together with the robot. You do this, they're going to do that, and they're going to ask you for help. I think that type of thing is really, that you're talking about, is more important when you have people who aren't already signed up to work with the robots. So I think it's be cool to work on.
Well, it's been the speaker one more time.
Thanks, Anka.